Shalom! In this three-part series, we will study things you can do in GCC to add parallelism to your programs. Now, there are different definitions, but when I say parallelism, I mean your program does more than one thing at once. And I don't mean that it appears to do many things at once. I mean it literally does many things simultaneously. The plot device for this study is a Mandelbrot fractal renderer. This function is the core of the fractal calculation. Just to make it a bit more efficient than your first tutorial program, I added three simple optimizations. Namely, periodicity checking, which checks whether the value has already been seen earlier at one of the predefined moments. And some reformulations to minimize the number of branches the processor must execute, which will be very important later. And finally, this crazy formula which checks whether Z belongs inside the main cardioid or the largest sphere attached to it. You can learn more about fractal in Wikipedia if you are interested. For this video, I just needed a calculation-heavy task, and the fractal was the only reasonable thing that came to my mind, despite a year or so of deliberation. For reasons that will be evident later, this fractal renderer uses a homebrew logarithm function. If you have ever wondered how the computer actually computes these scientific functions, well, here you can see an example. The algorithm comes from the KFS math library, just simplified a bit so it does not deal with tricky corner cases. The bulk of the work is done by reading the exponent field directly from inside the float value, using bit masks and bit shifts, and then the rest is approximated with a Taylor series. You can learn more about this too in Wikipedia. Just look up Taylor series. Now in the upper right corner you can see how the output of this program will look. You can either follow along as I write the rest of the main program, or you can marvel the beautiful fractal, or you can just skip forward to until about 2 minutes and 52 seconds, when interesting things start happening. In the main loop, we go through the pixels of the image, converting x and y coordinates into complex coordinates. Each complex coordinate will be run through the iteration loop, and the result will be converted into a color. This color will be rendered as a pixel. The complex coordinates are changed each frame. As yet another optimization, the periodicity checking is dynamically enabled or disabled. A template parameter controls whether the checks are compiled in. Periodicity checking is enabled if at least one pixel in 1000 were inside the set, and disabled otherwise. And now, this graph shows the performance of this vanilla program. Some parts of the process were faster and some were slower. It begins rendering at 1 second per frame, and ends at 40 seconds per frame. We have already done several improvements to the rendering algorithm. Perhaps in reality there is still more that could be done. But for the sake of getting finally into the actual topic, let's imagine we have done already every possible algorithm improvement, turning all the n squareds into n log n's, and so on. How can we still make the program faster? Let's understand how modern computers work. Suppose you have two arrays of integers that you add together. The integers are 32-bit. You have a modern PC. What do? The trivial answer is shown on the screen. Some programmers might be inclined to use a loop, but unrolling the code works better for this lesson. You do not need to know any assembler to understand this. We have 16 integers in one array and 16 integers in another array. These arrays are added together. So we have 16 load operations and 16 add operations. As an optimization, the add operation also stores the result. A total of 32 instructions are executed on the CPU. But the PC can do much better. Since 1997 there have been instructions that can do two 32-bit add operations at once. My computer can do it, your computer can do it, everyone's computer can do it. This is called SIMD, single instruction multiple data. With these MMX SIMD instructions you only need 24 instructions to add these two arrays. But the PC can do even better. Pentium 4 introduced the SSC2 instruction set over 15 years ago. With these instructions it is possible to perform 4 32-bit additions with a single operation. but the PC can do still better. Advanced vector extensions. My computer has it, and with this architecture, you only need 6 instructions total to load 16 integers, add them with another 16 integers, and store the results into 16 integers. But it still doesn't end here. A CPU that has AVX 512 can do the whole thing with just 3 instructions. A tenfold speed up compared to the traditional way faintly seen on the background. So, how do we tap this immense power from within the C++ compiler? Oh yes, we can. The answer is arrays. Make everything an array. Vector. They are called vectors even though they are really arrays. When we speak to the compiler, we say array. And when we speak to a scientist, we say vector. To process things in parallel, we must have things to process in parallel. Let's begin with a humble improvement. Attempt to process 8 pixels simultaneously with vectors. The basic idea is this. For every single calculation, do it to all values in an array instead of to just one value. Compilers today are smart enough that they automatically convert these array operations into those extremely efficient vector instructions that we saw earlier. You just need to give them a chance. Well, reputable compilers. I would not trust Microsoft Visual Studio to do it, but at least GCC and Clang are pretty good at it. And they are getting better and better at every release. Intel's Compiler Studio is also very powerful, but over the past years they have transformed it into encumberware, making it extremely difficult to acquire and install a free copy. So I cannot test it. Now, SIMD has some limitations. Because it literally means applying the same instruction to multiple data, you cannot vectorize different functions or code that is full of if-elses. You can only vectorize operations that are identical across all data. All data items must be subject to exactly same processing. It is possible to do conditional processing within SIMD, but it requires some tricks. For instance, Mandelbrot fractal calculation involves loops that run a different number of iterations depending on situation. For each pixel, a different and unpredictable number of loops is run. In this simplified example, 76 loops are needed to render 32 columns. You can vectorize these different columns, of course. For example, 4 columns could be calculated simultaneously. Does this mean a 4-fold speedup? No, unfortunately it does not. Remember, all data within the same vector must be subject to the same treatment. This also means the same number of loops. In reality, it would look like this. 3 loops are performed on each column in the first vector, 5 loops for each column in the second vector, and so on. Now, even though the number of loops must be the same for all items in the vector, it is possible to write code so that only particular elements in the vector are affected. As a result, we get something like 2.5-fold speedup compared to processing each column separately. The bottom line is this. Performance does not necessarily increase at the same rate as the vector size does. It may not even increase at all. It really depends on the data. Let's have a look at the actual benchmark now. Ah yes, it's clearly faster now. Wow, what was that? Suddenly it became as slow as the non-vectorized version, and now it's back. Wow, again! What just happened? In the end, it is twice as fast as the previous version, but these sudden jumps were strange. Let's take a look at the code. This is the iterate function. Ah yes, see here, these are the SIMD instructions I was talking about. Beauty. It is delightful to look at code that accomplishes stuff. But wait, what is this? These are not vectorized even though they should. The compiler failed to optimize them properly. Is there a way we can force the compiler to generate SIMD code even when it thinks it might not be a good idea? Glad you asked. In fact, there is a very simple way. Openmp is a cross-platform extension that defines pragmas that control how the compiler generates code. We can pepper the code with a few strategically placed pragma-omp SIMD, which essentially say to the compiler, try harder. The performance of this program is virtually identical to the previous version, except the weird underperformance hiccups of the implicit SIMD version no longer exist. The program is almost perfectly twice as fast as the initial version. Intel Silk Plus is another extension supported by GCC that also provides pragmas that tell the compiler to try harder. We will look into Silk Plus in more detail in the next episode, but to utilize Silk Plus SIMD directives, this was all that you need to know. The performance is exactly same as with OpenMP, which makes sense. It is still the same compiler, just commanded in a different language. Now there is still one avenue I haven't tested. Using Intel Intrinsics. Intel Intrinsics are a bit different. You are confused, let me explain why. See this code on the screen? This is how the code becomes with Intel Intrinsics. I'm not kidding. Here is how the whole program looks with Intrinsics. This code combines the worst sides of C and assembler. It must be written with a specific processor architecture in mind, and it will neither compile nor run on anything other than that architecture. And here's how it runs on my computer. Across the board, it is about 3 times faster than anything else so far. Curiously, the parts where periodicity checking is disabled, which is the parts that were exceptionally slow in the implicit SIMD version, are exceptionally fast in this version. Conclusion: modern microprocessors are very powerful, and modern compilers are really smart. But the common wisdom that you should not try to outsmart your compiler, because allegedly chances are that it knows a whole lot more about optimization than you do. Well, I think I just proved that to be hogwash. We made the program 3 times faster, without adding threads and without changing the algorithm, simply by doing the compiler's job, but better. I am Bisqwit. The next time we will see what happens when we bring threads into the mix. And how to do threads in GCC. There are surprisingly many ways. Have a very nice day, and see you soon again.